Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Williston Presbyterian Church. Hope you have a sense of the grace and peace in this place. Good to have you with us this morning. Do take note of all the announcements in our bulletin, the things going on in the life of our church. I also want to announce that condolences to the family of Bernice Smith, who passed away earlier this week, and whose services were held for her yesterday. And our thoughts and prayers go with the Smith family. Also, Linda passed away yesterday, and Ham. It is so good to, Linda Dix would be so proud to have you in church today, and the family in church today, so well done. And our thoughts and prayers go with the Dix family. She was buried yesterday at the Mole Funeral Home and at the cemetery in Barnwell. Please keep all those folks in your thoughts and your prayers through the week and the months. We now come to the time of our special bulletin. Anybody have it? Anyone want to fess up? This is, well, then I have it. No. Oh. Well, next week, if you're hiding the special bulletin, we'll pray for you anyway. Okay, we'll now have our choral call to worship. If you're able, I'd ask you to stand. I'm not used to this high technological stuff like having a mic. Let us join in together in our call to worship. We say we come to worship to be with God, but the beautiful truth is, so in this time together, let us worship God.
Thank you.
Please be seated. If we are faithful to confess our sins, our God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. In that great, sure, and certain hope, let us pray together our prayer of confession. Let us pray. Merciful God, we acknowledge our guilt and seek your face and your forgiveness. For we have not offered steadfast love to you or each other. We have not moved forward in faith, but have allowed ourselves to be still by fear. Revive us, raise us up, that we might live before you, rejoicing in the knowledge of your love. This statement is completely true. Our Lord and Savior Christ came to save sinners. Sinners just like me, and sinners just like you. He personally bore with his body on the cross our sin, so that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that's fresh and new. If anyone is in Jesus Christ, he or she is a new creation. The past is finished and gone, and all things are made fresh and all things are made new. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. I see Allison can't be with us today, but Bob is here. I knew someone would come forward.
That's what you get. That's what you get. So we're going to take up our pocket change offering here. Let's go over to Paula. Avery. All right. Thank you. You can help too. Days, these big bags of We sometimes forget that the little things that we can do in life can be used to help glorify your name and tell others about Christ. We ask that you go with us and lead us and guide us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. We now come to our time of prayer, and I'd ask you, is there any prayer requests? Yes.
My granddaughter Carson Holliday was baptized this morning. Thanks for taking my old kids to see it.
Well, very good. Is he going to play golf? What's that? Is she going to play golf? Well, you know, Carson's one of those names that can, you know. I was born in Carson City, Nevada. How's it? Any other prayer requests? Okay, great. Okay. Any other requests? Okay. Let us go to God in prayer. Eternal and gracious God, we are so thankful that we can come before you in prayer, knowing that our intercessions, our thoughts, the innermost desires of our hearts are not something you ignore, but through love, something you help us to work through. We're grateful that you do listen to our prayers. But we also pray that we would have the strength and the courage when you answer those prayers for us to accept it, even if the answer is not what we expected or not what we wanted. Help us to echo the words of our Savior as he prayed, but not my will, but your will be done. So we're thankful that you are a God who loves and who listens. Help us to be a people who listens and lovingly obey. This day, our thoughts go out to all those who are in grief today. We do lift before your throne of grace the families of Bernice and the Dix. We're grateful that we can not only trust ourselves, that we can trust those we love into your hands, that were nail pierced for us so that we might live. So be with them now. We're grateful for the baptism of Carson and for the joy in her family today. Thankful that in that sacrament we declare that we are your children, O God, and that you love each one of us so completely. We're also thankful that June has completed those surgeries successfully, and we're grateful for doctors and nurses and therapists and all those in the healing profession who do so much for us. We pray you be with her now as she once again takes up the threads of her life. Oh God, there are many unspoken prayers that lie on our hearts today. Prayers that we don't want to make public. Prayers that are deep, yet prayers that are real. So now we take a moment to present those before your throne of grace. We pray all these in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew. We'll begin with the 9th chapter, the 9th verse, and we'll continue through the 13th. And then we'll travel to the 18th verse of the 9th chapter and finish with the 26th. But before we turn to God's holy word and the sermon, let us turn to God in prayer. Eternal God, we pray that your spirit would descend upon this place with power and that your word would be delivered with full assurance through the Holy Spirit. In the strong name of Jesus Christ, we ask it. Amen. As I say, our text begins with the 9th verse of the 9th chapter of Matthew's gospel. I take this reading from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. Let us now reverently attend to the reading of God's holy word. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when Jesus heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners. And now we will travel over to the 18th verse. While Jesus was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her and she will live." Jesus got up and followed him and with his disciples. Then suddenly a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she said to herself, "If I only touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned and seeing her said, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And when Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, "Go away, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been outside, he went in and took her by the hand. And the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout the district. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. These two small passages of Scripture have one challenge about them, is you could probably produce 7 or 8 sermons for those two passages. You're lucky, I've had a busy week and I've only prepared one. Could have been 1.5, 2, slung them all together, but no. It begins today with the call of one of the more famous disciples. You know, often, you know, some of the 12 disciples, they have names, but we really don't know much about them. But this fellow, we know something about. Matthew, the tax collector. Now, none of us who deal with the IRS in the past, and you get on the phone, we may not love IRS agents, do we? But we understand them. They're normal folks, most of them. You know, they're not on a power trip, most of them. But that's not the way it was for a tax collector in those times. They practiced an art that's very well known by the mafia and organized crime today. They were masters of loan sharking. You all know what loan sharking is. You have a gambling problem or you need some quick money and you go to the loan shark and he loans you the money, but he tells you out front, you know, the interest is 125% a day. And then a few months later, knowing that you're not ever going to pay it, because that's when they own your life. And they start beating you up, taking the money, doing all sorts of things to you. That's a loan shark. Matthew, let's be clear, was a Judean loan shark. But the difference was, a loan shark back then, they had thugs backing them up. You know, part of the crime family. Joe Bananas, those kind of thoughts, you know, Lucky Luciano, you know, you got the backing. Well, Matthew had a different kind of backing. See, no matter what kind of tax collector he was, could have been for Herod. You know, Herod has his taxes. He was the tetrarch of the area. Well, if you were a tax collector for Herod, you had the Herodian guards. So sure enough, there at the tax booth, Herod would have a group of Herodian, or Matthew would have a group of Herodian guards. If he was a Roman tax collector, well, then he would have Roman legionnaires there with him. And if you didn't get the taxes or have the money, well, you dealt with the Roman soldiers. You dealt with the legionnaires. You dealt with Herodian guards. And they weren't nice people. But worse than that, you see, when Matthew became a tax collector, they didn't say, here's Matt, here's the contract, this is, we'll pay you 50,000 denarii to be a tax collector. That's not how they made their money. They made their money by skimming off the top. Another thing well known in the mafia, particularly Nevada, where I'm from. They skim money off the top. You see, if Herod, if you owed 15%, to Herod, they would charge you 20 or 25. And that was legal. And they had the soldiers to back it up. Now, how would you feel about IRS agents if they could do that to you? Couple that
with the fact in that religion of the time, with the Pharisaic beliefs, to be in that profession is to be unclean, because you're dealing with folks who aren't ritually pure, ritually acceptable. Put it in human vernacular, you had to deal with your bosses, your people who you were unkosher. They're unclean. They were despised. So of all the, my old preaching professor, Tom Wong, wrote a great commentary and interpretation on Matthew. And he says, we today do not realize how despicable tax collectors were considered in that society. They needed guards. You all remember the story of Zacchaeus? You know, climbed up the sycamore tree and that kind of thing. We all sang that song, at least some of us did. And we think it's because he was a wee little man. You know, Zacchaeus was, I won't sing it, don't worry. We think it's because he was so short. Well, I think he was little for other reasons. He was little on character, little on all sorts of things. And the reason why he climbed up the tree is to keep people from beating him up. Because if he had, without the children with him, because if he had just gone in Jericho with the other folks, Zacchaeus would have probably been beaten to a pulp. You're safer up on the tree. So, they're despicable. And here Jesus says, and the Pharisees see it, he calls Matthew the tax collector. And they go berserk. They run to Jesus' followers because Jesus, it's like you got a guy in the gutter and then you just keep on kicking him. You got someone with a wound, you just pour salt on it. He doesn't just stop with calling Matthew. He accepts Matthew's invitation to dinner. And at dinner you have all these, but those people consider reprobates, prostitutes, other tax collectors, Gentiles. Everybody that would make the Pharisees hate what's going on there. If you ever wonder why they were so against Jesus, it's right there. Let me put it today. I wanted to say Billy Graham, but I'll put it in the next generation. Suppose you walked in on Franklin Graham at a cafe in Columbia or Aiken, and he's sitting there eating there with a known criminal, having fun. A prostitute, a pickpocket, and a thief, and someone just released from prison for murder. And Franklin's having a great time with him, talking it up, having a root beer. I just picked that. You wouldn't like it. Well, they couldn't stand it. They couldn't stand it. They couldn't stand to have Jesus do that. You see, they were the insiders of the Jewish faith. They're the ones who sort of called the balls and strikes in the synagogue. They were the ones who were the interpreters of values, morals, what's right and wrong. And they had developed such a neat, tidy system of 862 laws that everything was defined and clear. And here comes this fella, Jesus, who calls himself a teacher and a rabbi, and he's blown it up to smithereens. And they can't take it because they don't like outsiders. They just want insiders. And then we go on to our second passage, and we have two examples where Jesus, the first one, is a person who's a leader in the synagogue, an insider. And Jesus treats that person with just as much love, the head of the synagogue, as he raises the daughter, as he did the reprobates and the hated. And then we have the Syrophoenician woman, a Gentile, unclean. To have blood like that, if I might be blatantly blunt, you're considered unclean. She's been considered unclean, unworthy, untouchable for 12 years, for whatever years it says in the scripture. Was it 12 years? I forget. And yet Jesus treats her with dignity and love and grace as he heals what's happening to her. So, I'll take one thing from this text. Jesus cares for both insiders and outsiders. I think he was very, very angry at the Pharisees. We all know he got angry at them, but he cared for them too. The problem was on their part, not his part. Now, I don't think that I'm going to stun anybody by saying, in our culture, don't we have insiders and outsiders too, to start with? People who are insiders are the determinative of leadership and what's right and what's wrong. It happens in the church. I could show you my wounds through over 37 years of church fights. A fight between people who thought they were insiders and outsiders and not liking either one. I remember I was the chair of a commission that went in to try to compose the problems of one of the most largest influential churches in Detroit, Michigan, where some of the titans of the auto industry and the law industry were members, and they were torn apart. They were torn apart by doctrine, by theology, and by politics. Of course, the largest percentage were progressive people in that church, but there was a group of about 30%. They were the older persons in the congregation who were much more conservative, much more traditional. And as time went on, and particularly as the time came to call a new pastor, that church blew up. So I went there, and we had a listening session. And I told my fellow people, this is a listening session. That means we don't interrupt. That means even if you get really angry about what's said, you just keep your mouth shut, because we're listening. And I'll never forget where one person, I won't tell you what side that person was on, they got to the point and they said, you know, it's got to the point that I can't even have communion with them. I look at them and what they stand for and their politics and their theology, and I just feel they're not worthy to be at communion, and I'm not going to have communion with them. Oh, I was so disappointed. I said it was just a listening session. And I wanted to scream at that person. You know, you're right about one thing. Those people aren't worthy. But either are you. Because we're all sinners. We're all in deep need of God's grace. And in God's eyes, we got to remember in the church that there is no insiders and there is no outsiders. And the greatest harm that comes to the Church of Jesus Christ, and has happened more to the Presbyterian Church than most, is we don't think that way. But there's also insiders and outsiders in our culture. I got good news for you today. Christianity is still the largest religion in the United States. I checked it today. It's like 63%. Isn't that good? But the most important good news here is where the main growth of the church. You know what the fastest growing Christian, the fastest growing place where Christianity is flourishing more than any other country? You'll never guess it. China. Did you know that? Hong Kong, Singapore, Korea. It's booming. I'll never forget when I was a young seminary student And it was during the Tiananmen Square stuff that happened in the late 1980s. You remember that, the wonderfully brave student who stood before the tank? And we were talking to seminarians who knew everything in the world. There must not be any Christians in China, the way that that repressive regime is stamping it out. And old Sam Moffat, my missions professor, born in North Korea, his dad was a missionary, went to prison in Red China during the Cultural Revolution, was kicked out of the country, and he was there as the distinguished professor of missiology. And he looked at us and he smiled, and he says, "You people don't know anything. Nothing stops the Church of Jesus Christ, especially when it's oppressed." Today, in China, there's 45 million Christians that are in organized churches, churches that the government supports. But far more than that, we don't know how many. Conservatives, numbers is 100 million. There are what they call house churches, people who don't want to have government authority as they worship Christ. And so they meet in houses, and they're all over the country. I say that's good news because they're outsiders. But usually when the church is outside in an oppressed country, good things happen. So let's pray for them. But what about us? I said that there were 62% Christians. You know what it was when I graduated from seminary in the 1980s? 90%. 90%. We've gone from 90% to 62%. I suppose there's all sorts of reasons for that. One of the reasons is the culture in many ways, maybe because of the arguments of science or misunderstanding who we are or stereotyping who Christians are. For a lot of places, we're a bit of outsiders. Isn't that amazing? That in the United States of America, we're outsiders to a lot of people, not insiders. How can you say that about Presbyterians? That was funny. How can you say that? How can that be? One of the main things this text teaches us is, yes, Jesus loves the insiders, but he also loves the outsiders, and he makes a special point of it. Not only here, he came to be with those who are sick, the sinners, but also he talks about the lost sheep. Well, I'm telling you today, in the United States of America, the number of lost sheep, for whatever reason, is growing. And Jesus calls us. It's the heart of this text. It's what the gospel writer's trying to say. That the Church of Jesus Christ is called to love the outsiders. That's exactly what it means. So the first question is, who are the lost sheep in our area? You ever thought of that? You ever considered that? I'll tell you, once you got them identified, I'll tell you, this is just the truth. We have to accept the fact that their values are not the same as our values. That's why, for us, they're considered lost sheep. 90% of those who've left the Christian church have not gone from Baptist or Presbyterian or Lutheran to Buddhism. They've gone to non-belief, secular. And so their values are different. When your values are different, the culture's different. And we have to accept that. So the question is, because we're called to love the outsiders, we're supposed to compose ourselves to be the unified body here, but once we've done that, we're called to love the outsiders. I guess you call that evangelism. So what do? Well, we recognize the truth. I suppose one just honest reaction is they frustrate us. Sometimes they frustrate me. I'm an old-fashioned guy, okay? I'm still not very good with computers. I don't know how to do Apple Music yet, okay? I'm the worst texter in the world. I'm trying to get used to Kindle. I love the internet because it is a great source of information, and I'm a person who loves information. I just eat it up. But I'm realize that I come from a different place. And so I get frustrated. Maybe you do too. Why does that person think that way? Why are they doing that? I wasn't brought up that way. Well, I can't believe they're doing those things. Isn't that a natural reaction for those folks? Then there's the next level. You're not just frustrated with them, they're angry at them. I've been angry. I got 3 sons. In the modern culture, they're good with computers. They used to text at dinner. It used to drive me crazy. I outlawed it. Some of the things, the influences they've had have made me angry. I've been upset. I wasn't raised that way. And they said, well, I'll tell you what they said. Next step is to get angry at them. The next step is to view them as an enemy, to not like them. I can't stand the people who are doing this to our culture. I can't stand what they're going to do. I don't like them. I don't like them. I want to stamp them out. Isn't that true sometimes?
When we react to those folks,
the lost sheep that are growing larger and larger in our country, if there's ever a country,
it needs a new revival in the United States.
Right now, it needs another Great Awakening, needs another George Whitefield, needs another John Wesley. Jesus doesn't call us to do that. Jesus calls us to love them. Now that can be a different thing for different people. Not everybody has to love them a certain way. There's no prescribed way to love people. But let me ask you a couple questions. When you've identified the outsiders, for whoever they are you willing to talk with them? Are you willing to stand with them and be with them and listen to them? This statement condemned me a little bit, made me stand up and take notice. Mother Teresa, she said, you know, everybody likes to talk about the poor. I can't tell you how many session meetings I've been where we've been talking about the poor. Natural thing to do. But then she said this. The problem is, everybody wants to talk about the poor, but nobody wants to talk with the poor. Stand with them. Help them. Tell them that Christ loves them. Not just form a program for them, which would be good too. Are you willing to talk with them and try and have a commonality with them? On another level, let me just say it. Are you willing to pray for them? Not pray that they become like you. That's not appropriate. Who are you to be the model? Pray that they would discover the love of God. Pray that they would learn that they're precious before God. Pray for them. But I'll tell you this, when you start praying for others, I've learned this in my life and I believe it. Praying for others is meaningless if you don't get up and help them. with your prayers. As the part of the body of Christ, aren't you supposed to be, me and you, aren't we supposed to be part of the answer? Show them you care for them. Tell them you're praying for them. How about this? Actually praying with them, whether they like it or not. I've done that before. That really, that's good. I went to go see a family member who was an atheist one time in a hospital. And I said, can I pray with you for you? And he said, no. And I said, well, I don't care. I'm going to pray anyway. He didn't throw me out. Who knows what happened? Are you willing to pray for them? Most of all, and that's what Jesus does here. Are we here in Williston and Columbia, everywhere, Barnwell? And I'm not talking about romantic. I'm not talking about emotional. I'm talking about just basic Christian love, charitas. Are you willing to love them? To care for them enough to pray that they will find God? Are you willing to love them, help them if they need a hand up? You see, the Christian church is most effective. It's been proven decade after decade and century after century. Don't worry, I'm almost finished. The end of the sermon's almost over. I'm not going to start another one. It's been proven over and over again that the church is always based on the love of Christ and how you show that love to others. And that's the challenge for me, and that's the challenge for you. So let's quit any kind of insider outsider in this church. I know there isn't. And let's march forward, loving the other. Amen. Let us rise and reaffirm what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, descended into hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, Holy Catholic Church, communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Will the ushers please come forward?
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for these gifts, what they represent. We pray that we would always be good stewards and use whatever's been given to us wisely, proclaiming your word. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Without being political in any way, we all know this has been a hard week for our country, and we seem so divided, so separated. It's my rock hard belief from the top of my head to the bottom of my heart, the answer to that is Jesus Christ. So I challenge you with this verse by the Apostle Paul. In Jesus Christ there is neither male nor female, Jew nor Gentile, slave nor free. As the children sing, all God's people got a place in the choir. And now may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your backs. May the sun shine warm upon your face and the rains fall softly upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the hollow of his hand. God bless you. Amen.